Day Street Books and Harper Audio present Special Characters, My Adventures with Text Titans and Misfits by Laurie Segall. This is the author. To all those who live their lives full of lobster moments. A note from the author. The events and experiences detailed in this audiobook that you're about to listen to are all true and have been written as I remembered them to the best of my ability. Some names and identifying details have been changed to protect the privacy of the subjects I wrote about. I've also condensed and combined stories to fit a wild decade into this audiobook and recreated dialogue to best represent that time period. Though conversations come from my recollection, my brain is not yet powered by artificial intelligence, so they aren't written to represent word-for-word documentation. They come from dozens of reporter notebooks, personal journals, text messages, and notes typed up in my phone that, thankfully, never disappeared. Luckily, I'm a bit sentimental and have kept detailed journals throughout my career. Also, most of my important conversations with Tech Titans were recorded live for everyone to see. All of the dialogue and stories you're about to hear are retold in a way meant to evoke the real feeling and meaning of what was said at the time, in keeping with the mood and spirit of the event. Happy listening. Prologue. The Lobster. A wise-looking rabbi named Dr. Abraham Twersky gazes into the camera, his long white beard giving him an extra air of importance against the black backdrop as he explains the anatomy of a lobster. The rabbi begins his online sermon with a description: a soft, mushy animal living inside a hard shell. At first, it's comfortable there, but that rigid shell can't expand. The lobster feels pressure and discomfort as it grows larger, and the shell becomes tight and confining. Eventually, he explains, the lobster hides somewhere safe while it casts off the old shell and grows a new one. It's important to note, he continues, that the lobster is incredibly vulnerable in this moment of growth as it hides under a rock formation, protecting itself from predatory fish and other creatures of the sea. But the discomfort is well worth it. Stress may begin the process, but by the end, the lobster has a new shell that fits. Of course, the lobster continues to grow, and eventually the new shell becomes confining, and the lobster must repeat the process. The only way for the lobster to grow is to feel the discomfort, stress, and vulnerability that come along with shedding its shell to grow a new one, over and over again. Chapter 1. Showtime. Ma'am, are you okay? The cop had pulled over, and his partner rolled down the window. Maybe it was my heels. I must have been wobbling as I walked across 2nd Avenue. At 5'5", I'm committed to wearing at least 4 inches, but that doesn't mean I do it gracefully. The streets, which were usually filled with herds of NYU students bouncing between East Village bars, were now empty. I glanced at my iPhone as the driver of the police car cut the engine. It was 4:03 a.m. on August 18, 2008, my 23rd birthday. I adjusted my white-collared button-up that I deem appropriate attire for anything professional and gave my best smile to the baby-faced cop and his older partner. Oh yeah, I'm totally fine. I was far too enthusiastic for this time of day. My body vibrated with the kind of energy you have before the years tick by and the circles under your eyes deserve their own nicknames. The kind of enthusiasm the policeman would surely deem a cover-up for a 23-year-old trying to appear sober. "It's a bit early to be walking here," he said. "This isn't a safe area for a woman alone this time of the morning. Do you need a ride?" I wasn't sure how true that was. The East Village seemed like a pretty safe place, even at 4 a.m. A part of me doubted whether I would have found myself in the same scenario had I not been a young white woman making her way to work. I hesitated. Should I ride in the back of a cop car or wait for the subway? After a bit of mental calculus, balancing the subway or a free ride, I climbed into the back seat. 58th and 8th, I called. So where are you headed this early? The younger cop said, looking in the rearview mirror. It's my first day on the job, I paused, at CNN. It was the first time I'd said it. I let the words linger in the air. Fancy, the older cop barked, winking, then taking a swig of coffee. I grinned. I didn't tell him it was a tentative position as a freelance news assistant. And I certainly didn't tell him that my biggest accomplishment so far as a budding journalist had been getting a toe in the door. It involved every skill I had. Tenacity, without being annoying. Creativity. And above all, scrappiness. I'd been working toward this moment for a decade. As the police car came to a stop, I thanked the officers and exited to a lightning sky. The sun had yet to rise on the postcard view of Central Park. The streetlights danced across the buildings. It wouldn't be long until the scent of vendors selling honey-roasted nuts and coffee for morning commuters filled the air. I took in a deep breath and looked around at the quiet streets, listening to the yellow taxis cruise by. As I walked through the revolving doors of one Time Warner Center, I felt like I was walking onto a movie set, complete with opening credits to my own life. Inside the building, everything was dark and marble, and in the early hours, completely silent. Apart from the clicking heels of rushed producers making coffee runs before the morning shows began, entering and exiting seamlessly with electronic badges. The security guards sat in an authoritative row near the doors, and one of them noticed me stalling near the turnstile. "Miss," he said, looking over, his eyebrow raised, his demeanor questioning how I'd made it into the building. "It's my first day," I said with unchecked enthusiasm. He grunted and pointed me to another guard who ushered me to the 7th floor. There, yet another guard who didn't share my enthusiasm took a snapshot of me smiling too widely, adjusting my collar in time for the flash. Then I was shuttled back down the elevator to the 4th floor, where dozens of desks dotted the open newsroom. Cameras stretching their necks like giraffes hovering over the jungle of tangled monitors and blinking screens. Day or night, the newsroom was a labyrinth of incoming feeds, lights from the control rooms flashing on and off. Edit bays where TV segments were cut to be later aired on shows like Anderson Cooper 360 lined the hallways. I'd spent the last week researching the producers I'd be working for, the ones who'd reported on 9/11. They were the hard-nosed journalists who ran toward the buildings, risking their lives to relay the news, documenting the horror of that day almost 7 years ago. I had scrolled through YouTube videos, listening to their voices stating the facts. I studied their names, pressing pause and play over and over again. They were the real deal, and I was entering their bullpen. I'd be training under the best. I took a seat and waited with a handful of other freshly minted news assistants. Despite my excitement, I knew where we stood. We were freelancers, entry-level nobodies with a 1-year trial period to impress the right people or else get out. I knew I'd have to find a way to make myself stand out in a sea of ambitious journalism hopefuls who'd made it this far. With relentless work, the right advocates, and perfect timing, I'd have a shot at a full-time position. As the others exchanged tips and small talk, I sat silently, watching as producers stalked in and out of the newsroom, reporters marched around in their heels, and desk managers barked orders into their phones. I felt both terrified and like the luckiest person in the world. Chapter 2. Wrecking Ball. My path to the newsroom started in middle school, the awkward and uncomfortable years when we have yet to settle into ourselves, the years we're told we'll grow out of. I was a pudgy preteen in an oversized flannel sweatshirt draped over khaki pants, the ones big enough to hide my discomfort in my own body and the insecurity that came along with that. It was a bright autumn morning when my mother set my brother and me down on the pinstripe couch and told us that our father didn't love her anymore. She closed the curtains, and a new era began. It was painful, and I struggled to adjust to the unsteady new family dynamic. one where my father was no longer an everyday part of my life, and my mother was grappling with a broken heart and the anger that now filled our home. Our gray wooden house at the top of a long driveway in the leafy suburbs of Atlanta had a shadow cast on it. I retreated into my journals, where I wrote about the battles happening under our roof, stories about strangers, and suburban observations. I poured myself into the act of writing, filling worn notebooks with song lyrics that resonated with the isolation I felt. I held tightly to my friends' families, to their warmly lit homes full of laughter and home-cooked meals. In the meantime, my mother tried to comfort us by taking us to a suburban Mecca, McDonald's. We went at least once a week, my mother trying to help us feel normal, to give us something to look forward to. During this time, McDonald's introduced a new promotion. If you supersized your order, you could play Monopoly. Dutifully, we supersized our fries and sodas, peeling off the thumbnail-sized playing pieces, hoping to win a prize or get a Monopoly. As in the real game of Monopoly, everyone wanted Boardwalk. It was the most expensive property, and if you got that royal blue tab, you could win $1 million. Within a year, I'd gained 15 pounds and was one card away from $1 million. All I needed was Boardwalk. The quest became my escape from reality, from the snobby suburbs of Atlanta, the divorce, the pain, and the overwhelming desire to fit into a world that seemed carved out for other people. Perhaps if we had $1 million, my mother wouldn't worry about our shifting financial reality. If we were to achieve Boardwalk, the cruel middle schoolers on the bus whose mothers refused to accept mine into their stifling circles, whose worst weapons weren't their sharp words, but their general disinterest, would pay attention to me. If we won the game, maybe my father would call more frequently. I was a good girl, not by choice, but by instinct. Instead of staying out past curfew and dabbling in mischief, I felt a responsibility to be my mother's plus one, to stay by her side and take on an adult role that included emotional support. My father, despite being a well-loved doctor, bristled at my anger. His new home was on the other side of town, but it felt like the other side of the country. Our family collectively ached, all of us unable to fully process the pain, manifesting in choose-your-own-adventure coping mechanisms, most of them unhealthy. Class photos with tack holes stabbed through the eyes. Doors slammed, and fingers and hearts broken. Our house, once filled with nightly piano recitals and spaghetti and meatball dinners, was paralyzed with anger. I remember my parents touching only once, years before. I'd held it with me, playing it over in my head like a song on repeat. My mother and father were driving me and a friend to the movie theater. We sat in the back of our white minivan, chattering as the car filled with music. Frank Sinatra's The Way You Look Tonight began playing. My father looked over at my mother, his mouth creeping into a warm smile, and placed his arm around her shoulders. When she beamed back at him, I knew this was their song. Now the music was replaced with muffled rage. As chaos swirled around me, I felt invisible. But I always held on to the hope of something better, of Boardwalk. Something better was just one meal away, somewhere around the corner. Spectacular existed. A life where tight-knit communities in the beautiful green suburbs were non-judgmental of broken families. Where holiday dinners had five types of pie and heaps of laughter. Where I wasn't numb and scared and invisible. Where anything was possible. I cried myself to sleep when my brother went to boarding school, far from our chaotic home. I dug half moons into my palms when I transferred to a new school in hopes of branching out from Holy Innocents Episcopal School, a Southern conservative high school where I was one of the only Jewish girls. No matter how much I had tried to fit in, I stuck out. I didn't have blonde hair, blue eyes, or parents who owned part of the Coca-Cola empire. When one of the boys told me I was going to hell because I didn't believe in Jesus, I laughed reflexively and shrugged. Wondering if there would ever be a place where I didn't have to try so hard to laugh off the feeling of being an other. I was uncomfortable in my own skin, in my tiger-striped retainer and frizzy hair that wouldn't stay behind my ears. But transferring to a new school, I felt even more invisible than I had before. The nice Jewish girls my mother told me about avoided eye contact. Our imperfect family wasn't warmly welcomed in those circles. Within a year, I transferred back to my old school, this time making my own space. Instead of attending tailgate parties,
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.